Tonight, with just 90 minutes to polling day, Newsnight captures the main party leaders campaigning to the last in the 2005 general election. Michael Crick's been on their tails all day as they buzzed around Britain in search of any and every vote.
Michael, how nice to see you. Where have you been on your expensive BBC helicopter?
So, you found the campaign boring and predictable? There were more surprises than you may remember. And we'll find out if any of Newsnight's posse of undecided voters in Milton Keynes have made up their minds.
You people are putting your future in the hands of people that you don't know. You're crazy.
And we look back at the election, the pollsters and some politicians got horribly wrong.
We're all right. We're all right.
The Conservatives will be hoping 1992 happens all over again. Good evening. In any general election, the aim of political leaders is to get to a point where a single word or phrase sells that party's message loud and clear. We've had 4 weeks of Labour banging on about moving forward, not back. The Conservatives' mantra of actions, not words, and the Liberal Democrats insisting they are the real alternative. But this has also been a campaign characterised by negativity and insult. So when the people deliver their judgment on it all tomorrow, will they be voting for the best policies or against the worst political excesses? In a moment, we'll be live in the leaders' constituencies. But first, Michael Crick has been out on his last campaign sortie, zigzagging Britain and trying to catch up with the leaders as they give it one last push. Nowhere to run, baby.
Nowhere to hide. Just after nine this morning, and our first want-to-be Prime Minister of the day, Charles Kennedy.
Are you hoping to be in Downing Street by the weekend then?
Well, I'm hoping that we're going to get a sizeable shift in the direction of the Lib Dems.
Does that mean you'll be in Downing Street by the weekend?
I don't know. That's in the hands of God and the electorate.
Is that a realistic possibility?
In those we trust.
He was in Brent East in northwest London, where the Lib Dems famously won a by-election almost 2 years ago on a strong anti-war vote. It was the highlight of the last Parliament for Mr Kennedy's party, and also spelt curtains for the then Tory leader Ian Duncan Smith. The Conservatives can't win was Mr Kennedy's message today. Not here, not nationally.
They are out of the race comprehensively, and therefore the decision is between Tony Blair's Labour government continuing or the real alternative, the Liberal Democrats.
Well, on the last day of the campaign here, Charles Kennedy and his party are clearly in optimistic mood, buoyed by the polls. On the other hand, if they're that optimistic of a huge breakthrough tomorrow, what are they doing visiting a seat that they've already won? So where have you been campaigning then?
Brent East.
So that's all? Surely you should be looking to make advances in other seats.
Wasn't it, I think, Chairman Mao who said every march starts with a single step, so you have to plant the seeds in one place and then expand further afield.
So it's still a long march to go, you think?
We have one Brent seat and there are two more to contest.
We're on our way to Norfolk, Great Yarmouth in fact, where this lunchtime, the local people are going to be blessed not just with one potential Prime Minister, but two.
In a seaside hotel, scores of Labour activists were waiting patiently to hear Gordon Brown. But his helicopter was running late, and that wasn't the only problem agitating Labour officials.
We've come all this way to Yarmouth to see Mr Brown.
Yeah.
I'm sure he'll be happy to have us here.
That's not what my instructions are.
Really, you don't think he is happy to have us here?
I don't know.
Right.
I don't know. But you're not on my list for today, so I will have to ask you to leave.
Well, we're not having much luck here in Great Yarmouth. First of all, ejected by Gordon Brown's people from this meeting, we've now heard that the other wannabe Prime Minister who was due here this lunchtime, Michael Howard, has had to divert because of the bad weather and go to Norwich instead. It wasn't so much a day for helicopters as for boats. And over the next hour, as we rushed across Norfolk, dozens of Tories were coming from all over the county to the same spot. Sent an SOS. Get to Norwich quick, they were told. The party leader needs an audience.
How much notice did you get at this meeting then?
Of course it got to do with you.
Obviously not much. Were you going to go to Yarmouth?
No. We had 10 minutes notice.
Ten minutes notice?
Yeah, dropped everything and so just came out.
What were you all doing?
Having a lunch.
You're having a lunch.
Just preparing lunch.
You didn't manage to finish your lunch, and you were working.
Working. Working in North Norfolk.
Then the man himself, in surprisingly good spirits. It must have been Liverpool's European Cup win last night, not the opinion polls.
Michael, how nice to see you. Where have you been on your expensive BBC helicopter? We've been missing you all campaign.
Thanks so much.
The class divide seemed alive and well. It was bigwigs through the front, and riffraff, like us, and the party foot soldiers had to trek round the back. From one viewpoint, the hastily convened meeting looked pretty impressive. Yet, from the other angle, not the best picture for a leader of the opposition on the eve of a general election.
Clear message. Use your vote tomorrow to take a stand. To take a stand on the things that really matter for the future of our country. Use your vote tomorrow. Vote Conservative. Vote Conservative tomorrow for a better, brighter future for Britain.
But when I pressed him on his own position after tomorrow, he took refuge in the Liverpool football manager.
You told your shadow cabinet the other day that if you screw up, if you don't deliver, then you're out. Doesn't the same apply to you if you don't deliver tomorrow?
Well, we're working towards winning tomorrow. We're putting into effect... We're putting into effect the words of Rafa Benitez, and I'm confident we'll have the same result.
And in Scarborough tonight, our fourth wannabe Prime Minister, or wanna-stay PM, was again playing it safe by sticking with his friends.
These are big dividing lines. They're big choices for the country.
There was little we hadn't heard before, but he finished by appealing to their progressive instincts.
We've done our best to serve our country. We want to continue serving our country, accelerate the change, quicken the progress, and never go back to that narrow, selfish individualism that we left behind in 1997. That's what we want to do. That's what we're going to fight for. That's what people should vote for tomorrow. Thank you.
So, a small historic moment there. Not just the last speech by Tony Blair in this election campaign, but what's probably the last speech that Tony Blair will make as Labour leader in any general election campaign.
Labour's prime task tomorrow is to shore up its vote.
Confident you're going to do it, Mr. Blair?
It won't be easy in marginal seats like this. On Scarborough Sands tonight, someone had scrawled Vote Labour out. And 36 hours from now, we'll know which of our wannabe prime ministers, like the words on the beach, have been washed away.
Michael Crick. So how have the number crunchers at the polling organisations been interpreting the electorate's voting intentions over the past few weeks? The BBC's poll of polls shows that despite being just 1% behind Labour at the start of the campaign, the Conservatives have over time seen that gap widen to 6 points, with the Liberal Democrats trailing a further 9 points behind. However, the very latest polls, which will be published in tomorrow morning's newspapers, show the Labour lead down 1, leaving the Conservatives just 5 points short. The Liberal Democrats remain on 23 points, up 2 from the start of the campaign. Well, right now we're going to the leaders' constituencies, and first David Grossman joins us from Folkestone, Michael Howard's seat. David, what's the mood among Tories there tonight?
Well, Kirsty, I was speaking to somebody inside the Conservative campaign earlier on this evening, and they told me there was a sense of relief when that latest clutch of polls that you've just been going through were sent through to Conservative central office. They put the Conservatives on between 32 and 33% of the popular vote, almost exactly the same proportion that William Hague got in the 2001 election. But the mood in central office was one of relief because they thought it could have been a lot worse than that. The final clutch of polls could have been worse. This morning there was a poll putting them on 27%, and that would have been clearly a lot worse. Now they think that it's all down to turnout, whether their voters turn out more than the other party's voters and whether they turn out in the marginal seats that the Conservatives have to pick up if they're going to make inroads.
And what about stories of grumblings in the Tory camp about the way the campaign has been run?
Well, there are certainly those who think that it was perhaps a mistake to concentrate so hard on immigration, asylum and tax. However, I detect an almost universal sense of pride, if you like, that at least they've put on a very good campaign. Whatever the result tomorrow, they put on a professional campaign. Apart from the Howard Flight speaking off message before the campaign itself properly started, they've largely kept unified, disciplined on message. The stories haven't been about Conservative infighting. A lot of the headlines have been on the subjects that the Conservatives wanted them to be on. And I'm told that Lyndon Crosby, the Australian strategist who was brought in, received a standing ovation at central office yesterday. That whatever else happens, that people inside the campaign say, remember what it was like 18 months ago when we were almost universally regarded as a sort of shambolic amateur hour campaigning party.
And where is Michael Hyde tonight? I take it he's not having a drink with Michael Crick.
He's not. He's not in Folkestone. He's still in Birmingham. I'm told he's going to go to the Conservatives' constituency strategy centre in Coles Hill tomorrow morning before coming down to Folkestone, where I'm told he plans to cast his vote in the early afternoon.
David, thank you. We're joined now by Jenny Scott, who's in Fort William in Charles Kennedy's constituency. What's the mood in the Lib Dem camp tonight?
Well, I have to say, it is pretty optimistic. I was speaking to party officials earlier, and they say that they're pretty confident in those key marginals where the Liberal Democrats are challenging the Conservatives, similarly confident in the marginals where they're challenging Labour. Where they're not so confident is in the seats where the Liberal Democrats won off the Conservatives last time. They say they're worried that a few voters, if they do switch to Labour, there's a chance that Liberal Democrats will lose those seats. But they do also feel that the last-minute momentum in this campaign is going with them. They think that the Tories haven't got much chance of winning, that Labour is flatlining at the moment, and that all the last-minute switches, they think and they obviously hope, will go to the Liberal Democrats.
Well, what about this Labour onslaught that a vote for the Liberal Democrats actually lets the Tories in? How are the party chiefs responding to that?
Well, they recognise it. They're very aware of this, which is why at every constituency we've been to with Charles Kennedy, and don't forget he's been to 39 constituencies in the last month or so, everywhere we've gone recently, he's been very keen to hammer home the fact that he says that the Tories can't win this. Having said that, there does seem to be some private recognition of this problem, this perception that voting for the Liberal Democrats is somehow a wasted vote. They're going on the basis that success breeds success. They say that in the constituencies where people believe that the Liberal Democrats can win, they get more votes, and therefore it becomes some kind of self-fulfilling prophecy. So they're very, very aware of the Tory party, the accusation that voting for the Liberal Democrats will give them Tories, but it's an accusation that they're also very keen to play down.
Right, Jane, thank you very much. Our political editor, Martha Carney, joins us in Sedgefield, obviously Tony Blair's constituency. Martha, what it's like up there?
Well, it's interesting, Kirsty. There's a very different feeling from when I was here exactly 4 years ago. Then Tony Blair spent the night before the election having a pint in the Labour Club just down the road. This evening, he's spending a much quieter time with his family in his constituency home just across the way from here. Perhaps a reflection of how very different this campaign has been for him personally. So we're not going to see him until tomorrow morning when he's going to come and vote in this little polling station behind me. This is Blair's going to be going to church. It's Ascension Day tomorrow. There was certainly a very strange scene here earlier on today, because three helicopters descended from the skies, bearing the police and Tony Blair and his wife Cherie and their oldest son Ewan. And I think you could detect a certain amount of relief that they were at the home stretch as they headed for their constituency house, because I think this has been a very grueling campaign for them. And in fact, I've been looking at how the election has unfolded for the Labour Party and for the Conservative Party and the Liberal Democrats over the past month or so. But I begin with looking at an election from 13 years ago.
Okay, how's it all going then?
Well, it's nearly finished.
It was a week before the 1992 election that I came to Sedgefield to film the young shadow cabinet member. It was also the morning that Labour had shot ahead in the opinion polls.
My goodness, those poll results are amazing. You sure that's right? 6 and 7%. So where are the Tories? Right. Better get preparing for government.
He didn't believe it, and he was right. But putting aside that small question of losing, 1992 was certainly a much easier campaign for Tony Blair. In 2005, Labour's much-mocked slogan, Forward, Not Back, was supposed to throw ahead to its plans for a third term, but it hasn't quite worked out like that. Tony Blair has had to find a reverse gear as he was dragged back to the past. Political necessity drove him to seek the help of his one-time ally turned rival. The start of the campaign brought a surprise announcement.
This is probably the most successful chancellor in Gordon Brown the country's had for 100 years. And so without breaching any of the protocols about how I decide things, we'd be pretty foolish to put that at risk.
Tony Blair had come to realise that Labour couldn't campaign on the economy without Brown's cooperation. But the Chancellor had told Alistair Campbell that would be difficult, with the constant speculation that he was about to be sacked. Hence, the New Deal. Gordon Brown backed radical reform in the public services and endorsed Tony Blair's decision on the war.
Not often you get something for free.
The Iraq War came to dominate the election campaign much more than Labour had anticipated. With a former MP's defection and leaked documents about the Attorney General's advice dominating the news agenda. Hostility towards Tony Blair over Iraq and other issues made the so-called masochism strategy seem positively sadistic.
I debate every week in the House of Commons with Michael Howard. I'm here to answer questions tonight.
All right.
I probably do more discussions.
Who likes sitting there being called a liar? Or who likes sitting there being shouted at? No, of course it's going to be difficult for him. However, there was clearly some sting to be drawn, perhaps. That was for certain. And I think it was a good way of showing, hey, Tony's a human being. Tony will go and talk to voters.
So with Tony Blair on the back foot, this should have provided the perfect opportunity for the Conservatives. But the polls suggest otherwise. The Conservatives had a clear campaign message, 10 words, pledges which they thought would cut through public cynicism about politicians' promises.
If you're thinking what we're thinking, it's time for urgent action on the things that really matter.
The campaign was initially praised for its professionalism. Their issues have cut through in the jargon. But opposition parties have criticised the Conservatives for too narrow a focus, and opinion polls haven't shown a breakthrough. Some Conservative MPs felt there'd been too much focus on immigration and think that the poster campaign calling Tony Blair a liar has backfired.
We're fed up with your broken promises. We're fed up with the way in which you've lied to win elections, as over tax, and we're fed up with the way in which you lied to us over the war. This is the British people's last chance to send that message to Mr. Blair.
One political consultant has identified a key group of voters in their 40s, Generation Jones, which he thinks holds the key to this election. Jonathan Pontell has been over in Britain for the election and has been advising the Conservative Party.
stepping back as an observer of any of the parties, including the Conservatives, I think it was a big mistake. That whole business of Blair's a liar and everything associated with that, I think was very counterproductive. And I saw in the polling, we've been sort of doing quite a bit of cross-generational polling, it was a I think a quite a big mistake. And as we've seen in recent days, there's been a softening of that.
But others believe that the campaign hasn't been bold enough, that the Conservatives should have promised much bigger tax cuts rather than competing with Labour spending plans. If the party loses, this is an argument which will erupt after the result.
Perhaps the Conservatives might get a bit more resolute in calling for tax reductions, and in particular, I think, for tax simplification. You've got many countries around the world now that have introduced a flat tax, some with rates as low as just 16%, and the reason they're doing it is not because they consider taxes too high, but because they consider taxes too cumbersome and difficult.
The Liberal Democrats have been trying to position themselves as the true opposition, with Charles Kennedy as a potential Prime Minister. Some had expected that the new Kennedy child would bring a baby bounce to his campaign. But instead, sleep deprivation took its toll.
You're talking in the region of 20 yeah, I mean, if you take a double income, take a double income couple, 20,000 each, that's what you're talking about.
40,000 pounds.
Yeah. £40,000, sorry, yes.
It was a difficult point for Charles Kennedy himself. I think it was accentuated by the sort of Westminster bubble of people, as it were, both from opposition parties and from the media, attacking him for his performance at the press conference. But I certainly thought that out in the country, people, particularly those people, many people who've had experience of young children, who've had those sort of sleepless nights, I think were much more relaxed about it.
Halfway through the campaign, the Liberal Democrats began to focus on Iraq, hoping that their opposition to the war would prove popular. But some maintain that the Lib Dem campaign, with its left-wing focus on higher tax, may actually drive some floating voters back to the Conservatives.
Right, how are you?
Some things have definitely changed since 1992, though perhaps not Tony Blair's preoccupation with Middle England, and certainly not the nervousness of all political leaders on the eve of an election.
And Martha joins us again. Martha, before your film there, you were talking about the certain relief that you thought that Tony Blair must have been feeling finally getting back to Sedgefield. But how does the Labour leadership think the campaign has gone for them?
Well, clearly the political imperative tonight is to get out the Labour vote. So they need to be saying that this is a very close contest, otherwise people won't bother to go to the polling stations. But having said that, a close aide of the Prime Minister was saying to me that having travelled a lot around the country, there are huge regional variations, that there's a very peculiar mood out there. They thought it was going to be quite difficult for them in Scotland. Someone else, I was talking to a campaigner in London, was saying that he'd seen a sample of postal ballots in a seat which has a 10,000 Labour majority, and they were very close indeed. Then a cabinet minister said they were expecting a Labour majority of between 90 and 100. So it clearly is a very difficult election to read.
What about any signs of Labour planning post-election, whatever that election result may be?
Maybe. Well, if you know, friends of Tony Blair say that he himself is incredibly cautious and he won't begin to think about anything like a cabinet reshuffle until he believes that there is a Labour victory. But journalists and politicians being what they are, of course there's a lot of speculation, a lot of what if Labour does win, what might that cabinet look like? And there are a number of questions there. Tony Blair signalled very strongly in the campaign that he wants to bring back David Blunkett. What kind of job might he have? I've heard that he'd be interested in taking over some of John Prescott's department. How does he reward Alan Milburn, who to a certain extent has been sidelined in the course of the campaign? Will he bring Stephen Byres back? So there's a lot of talk, but I think the top jobs, if Labour wins, are we know that Gordon Brown's going to stay as Chancellor. It seems very likely that Jack Straw will stay as Foreign Secretary and Charles Clarke in the Home Office. So there's a limited room for manoeuvre.
And what about the Tories? What are their plans for the future?
Well, if you talk to people in the Conservative campaign, as David Grossman was saying, they're pleased with the professionalism there. They say they're getting very good feedback from candidates on the doorstep, and that's certainly, when I've talked to candidates in seats around the country, they feel they're getting a very good feedback. But clearly, the opinion polls are making some people unsettled, and there has been criticism of the campaign. I spoke to a shadow cabinet minister recently who was saying that he thought that the Tony Blair liar poster was actually a catastrophe, and that if they lose, they'll have ended up putting themselves in a worse position for next time because they've reminded people how much they dislike the Conservatives. And so I think that if it is a bad result for the Conservatives, I think we will see sort of jockeying around leadership, and it'll be a lot of speculation about who's likely to stand, whether Michael Howard will be able to carry on. But having said all this, it's the eve of an election that a lot of people are saying is very, very difficult, large swathes of don't knows, so you can't possibly take anything for granted.
Martha, thank you. Well, to discuss all that, we're joined by Labour's David Miliband from Newcastle, by Andrew Lansley for the Conservatives from Cambridge, and by Simon Hughes and the Liberal Democrats, who's in the studio. First of all, Andrew Lansley, what people may well remember from this election is that the man who believes he'll lead the country on Friday repeatedly calling the Prime Minister of this country a liar. Is that something you're proud of?
No, what they're going to remember from this campaign is that in Michael Howard, they have somebody to elect as Prime Minister who is only going to promise what he will deliver, and is prepared to be judged on the actions that he will take, the timetable for taking those. And as Martha made clear in her package, that right from the very beginning of this campaign, Michael Howard had been nothing but crystal clear about what we're going to deliver for the people of this country. More police, cleaner hospitals, school discipline, controlled immigration, lower
Andrew
taxes,
Lansley,
and we will be accountable. And that accountability, which Michael Howard set out last year, was to be at the forefront of our campaign, is part of the question of trust and character. Mr. Blair, 8 years on, has made so many promises that he simply failed to deliver.
Well, if he has, Andrew Lansley, let's look at the opinion polls and the poll of polls. If he's failed to deliver, why is it that at best you're flatlining, and at worst you are in a worse position from when you started?
Well, Kirsty, you're just trying to debate the election the night before people make the decision, not pollsters, and they are going to go out there and they are going to have in their minds a Labour government that 8 years on talked about what it was going to deliver in public services, but as far as I'm concerned, I've been talking during the election about how we've got 5,000 people dying of hospital-acquired infections, how we're nearly
spending as much on health as Europe. Because we are looking at an eve of poll discussion.
About,
well, let's look at what Labour say it's about, and what the Prime Minister is reduced to, David Miliband, is sophology, scare tactics rather than trust. If 1 in 10 Labour supporters do not vote, the Tories will win. Apart from the debatability of the sophology of that, what does that say about a lack of trust in the Prime Minister?
Well, I think that this election has been significant because what we've seen is the argument for a progressive consensus in this country, a progressive consensus on economic policy in terms of a rising minimum wage, a progressive consensus on health and education policy in terms of the investment and reform we're talking about, a progressive consensus in respect of law and order and community. That progressive consensus can be built. The big arguments in this campaign, I think, have been won on the progressive side of politics. But what we know from our own history is that when progressives are split, you get the Tories in power.
But
and
what,
that's why
what
I think that the argument has been important to make over the last period.
But it's also important from your history that certain things in your party strike a lot of chords, and one of them is the Iraq war. David Blunkett said, it's downright self-indulgent of voting against the government purely on the war. Surely that denigrates Labour supporters who actually care passionately about whether Britain should or should not have gone to war.
No, the point we've been making is that the progressive consensus that we are building in this country in respect of economic and social policy is at risk if progressives split their vote. And I think that that is a very, very significant thing for people watching your programme tonight. There is a chance that we can entrench in this country a full employment economy with a rising minimum wage, that we can make our public services safe for a generation, but we can't do it if Labour and the Liberal Democrats split their votes. And that's why it's so important that we say to Labour voters, if you value the changes that have been made by this government, of course it's not paradise, but there has been significant progress in this country. And I think we've got to carry that on.
Well, significant progress, say Labour, Nothing, say the Tories, and here you are bang in the middle. Isn't the problem for the Liberal Democrats on eve of poll that actually people do not know which way you would jump in the event of a hung parliament? Labour supporters want to know that you wouldn't, if they come to you, you would not help a Tory government, a Tory hung parliament, and vice versa. You are now in a position where people do neither know your policies nor where you stand.
Well, let's deal with both of those. On the policies, we couldn't have been clearer. We say you can't get better public services without somebody having to pay more, and therefore we've suggested that the very rich would have to pay a little more. Tories say there'll be tax cuts, Labour say there'll be no more costs. We've made it clear that students and pensioners and householders need a better deal. We've made it clear that on foreign policy you go to war only when international law justifies it. So the policies have been clearer than ever I remember for 20 years. On the strategy, I have seen nobody seriously suggest that the likelihood, even as of tonight, is that there'll be a hung parliament, I know, overall majority. I've seen nobody say it. The polls you've just quoted...
So not much point in working voting for Liberal Democrats?
No, absolutely every point. If in the last parliament there had been 20 more Liberal Democrats, there wouldn't have been tuition fees or top-up fees. Every suggestion of the campaign has been that we've been going up and forward, Labour have been dropping, as you can see, in support, and the Tories have been going nowhere.
Andrew Lansley, are you comfortable about the emphasis on immigration in this campaign by the Tories?
It's been part of a campaign which
has
focused on... Are you
comfortable with the prominence of it?
Of course, because we've set out right from last year the things we're going to achieve, and even in the last few days Michael Howard has set out what the tasks are that go with it. I mean, for example, by the emphasis on controlled immigration amongst five key tasks, Michael Howard has said we need 24-hour-a-day border control police. We've heard the Labour Party and the Liberal Democrats following Conservative Party
policy.
Why, if it's important, infections, school discipline, or controlled immigration.
Can I just stick on controlled immigration? If it is so important, and it's one of the main stands of the party, why was immigration not mentioned in your own election leaflet? Isn't it the case that you're embarrassed by the emphasis on immigration?
No, because each of us in our election literature are focused on what is of most importance to our own particular voters. And I am the health spokesman for the Conservative Party. So if you look in my election literature, you will find me talking about how we're going to deliver cleaner hospitals, how we're going to support the National Health Service with additional resources, which I might remind you, Gordon Brown only today himself admitted that we, the Conservatives, have a programme for investment in the National Health Service right through the next Parliament. He and the Labour Party only have investment planned for the next 2 years and lower resources for the National Health Service in the subsequent 2 years.
When it comes to leadership qualities, good in a crisis, the latest poll, F.T. Murray, good in a crisis, Tony Blair, 19%, Mr. Howard, 5%, Charles Kennedy, 2%. The problem is that your leader isn't seen as strong, decisive.
I think if you look at all the other polls about leadership, if you look at the polls which ask who's in touch with the British people, who understands, which clearly the Prime Minister didn't, what happens when people go to their GP and are told they can't have an appointment, if you look at who is the sort of person people believe can relate to the British people, Charles Kennedy comes out on top. He's gained. He's gone up in the opinion polls. The party has gone. The really important thing, Kirsty, is that in this election, we've made the running. We were the alternative to the Labour Party in the last Parliament, and we've been the alternative to Labour during this election. And it won't be the Tories who come out looking as if they've been positive. It'll be us, and we're a credit to politics. I hope, and Charles has led that.
David Miliband, just finishing with you, isn't it time for a bit of honesty? The problem is that most of your second term was hijacked by the war in Iraq, and in fact people don't think you will deliver if you are given a third term.
Well, no, I think the dog that hasn't barked in this campaign is the delivery on domestic policy. I was in Scarborough a bit before Michael Crick this morning, opening a Sure Start centre there, and I think whether you look at the provision in respect of childcare and under fives provision, whether you look in the health service or whether you look in respect of schools and adult training.
Tell us about
I think what you've seen is
Scarborough. Well, the campaigning, I'm afraid, is nearly over.
Well,
thank you all very much indeed.
They were queuing in Scarborough for dentistry.
Coming up in the programme. Looking back at 1992 when the pollsters got it so wrong. And the results of our own poll of a group of floating voters. But first, a roundup of today's news. The party leaders have spent the day crisscrossing Britain, making their final appeals to voters. Tony Blair, Michael Howard and Charles Kennedy visited the marginal seats where they expect the general election will be won or lost when the polls open in under 9 hours' time. A man is to be charged with the murders of 29 people who died in the Omagh bombing 7 years ago. It's understood that Sean Gerard Hoey from South Armagh is already in custody on separate charges. He denies any involvement in the Omagh bombing, and I'm joined now by Liz McKean. What can you tell us about the man who has been charged?
Well, Sean Gerard Hoey, we understand, is a 35-year-old electrician originally from Jonesborough in South Armagh. As you say, we're told that he's in custody already, facing a number of terrorist charges, not linked to Omagh, but including membership of the Real IRA, the breakaway Republican group blamed for the attack. Now, he denies all those charges, and I gather that within the next month he's going to be served with prosecution papers outlining the 29 murder charges.
But briefly, he's the first person to be charged with this murder.
Yes, and that's what makes it so significant, especially for the families who were bereaved that day. And a number of them that I've spoken to this evening have said that they are certainly relieved, but they're also sceptical. As one of them said to me, we've been let down before. And that's because the original investigation was mired in controversy, accusations of incompetence. And in fact, some of the families have been so frustrated by the lack of progress, they've actually mounted their own civil action against the people they think were responsible.
Liz, thank you. In Iraq, at least 50 people have been killed in a suicide attack in the Kurdish city of Arbil. The bomber blew himself up outside a police recruitment centre. It's thought most of the victims were queuing up to join the local force. Police in Pakistan have arrested a Libyan man suspected of having close links with Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden. Abu Faraj al-Libi was wanted in connection with two attempts to assassinate President Pervez Musharraf. And the markets, the FTSE 100 share index closed up by 21 points, while in New York the Dow Jones closed up by 130 points. Against the euro, the pound was down. Against the dollar, the pound rose. The latest opinion polls for tomorrow's papers may all show a consistent Labour lead, but they're not the real deal. And if history is anything to go by, both the government and the opposition can hope the pollsters have been way off beam. There are plenty of instances where opposition exceeded expectation or the government bucked the trend. Now, for the final film in his series on great British elections, our resident historian Greg Neal turns to the 1992 election, when the early polls were confounded.
The spectre of Margaret Thatcher haunted the campaign of 1992. After 11 years in power and three election victories, Mrs. Thatcher had resigned in 1990. Could her successor, John Major, escape from her shadow? Honey, I'm still free. Take a chance on me. If you need me. Neil Kinnock, Labour leader since 1983, had sought to rebrand the party and moderate its policies, more red rose than red flag, but how would Labour fare now Mrs. Thatcher, not to mention her poll tax, had gone? Labour, focusing on a stuttering economy, enjoyed an early lead in the polls. But the campaign faltered, its broadcasts raising doubts, which the Tories would exploit with an expensive but effective series of adverts. A Tory film showed John Major as an unassuming man.
And that's the house we lived in for many years.
But soon he'd take the fight to the streets, in a soapbox. While polls still put Labour ahead, a rally in Sheffield seemed dangerously triumphant.
We're all right! We're all right!
Unimpressed, Tory papers kept up their attack. Polling day, and Labour gains were not enough. John Major still had a working majority. The pundits and the early polls had been confounded.
Greg Neal, well, it's almost time to bin the slogans of the 2005 campaign. And by now, you probably know whether you're thinking what they're thinking, or if you're going to value it and vote for it, or perhaps you're going, as I said earlier, for the real alternative. One of the masters of the political message is Frank Luntz, one of the most respected analysts of language and public opinion. He was employed by the Republican Party to help craft the slogans that brought them election victories. So we asked him to analyse public opinion in this general election, specifically in the marginal constituency of Milton Keynes North East. He first met a group of undecided voters in the town's art gallery at the very start of the campaign, and he's just been back.
Most Americans, when they come to England, only get to see Buckingham Palace. But I get to come back to Milton Keynes to see this. Actually, I'm here for a much more important reason. We're here to listen to the swing voters of Milton Keynes and whether, in fact, they have swung in these final few hours before Election Day. We'll get their reactions to the candidates for Prime Minister. We're going to use these dials to see how they respond to the various speeches during the campaign, and most importantly, whether these kinds of swing voters will actually vote come Election Day. I invited mostly the same people back to the gallery, though there were a few new faces. Back in 2001, 10 of them voted for Labour, 7 supported the Conservatives, and 8 backed the Liberal Democrats. But at the beginning of this campaign, almost all were undecided. But what I'd like to do is, if you can watch up here, just a few of the comments that you made, and then I'm going to ask you to take me right up to today, with the conclusion, with the election, hours away.
Labour won less than 2,000 votes in 2001.
Clearly, the strongest reaction last time came when they saw an image of Tony Blair and George W. Bush. They used their dials to show very strong disapproval. There was also an overwhelming concern about immigration and much distrust of Mr. Blair and Mr. Howard. Now impressions at the end of the campaign. Give me a word or phrase to describe this election, these last few weeks.
Negative.
Negative.
Low-key.
A very long campaign.
Opportunistic.
How many of you think this has been a positive campaign? Raise your hands. I'll try that slowly. How many of you think it's been a positive campaign? Raise your hands. How many of you think it's been a negative campaign? Raise your hands.
I think there's too much mudslinging.
They're having a go at each other all the time and it's just totally boring.
Particularly in the last few days with Iraq, it's been a very predictable campaign.
Word or phrase to describe Tony Blair after 4 weeks of campaigning?
Courageous.
Insincere.
Judgment.
Give me a word or phrase to describe Michael Howard.
Likeable.
Negative.
Negative.
After 4 weeks, after the campaign, with hours to go before you have to vote, a word or phrase to describe Charles Kennedy?
Honest and principled.
Honest.
Truthful.
In the past few weeks, I've caught up with a few old political friends and met some new ones, including members of Newsnight's election panel. First, Peter Hyman, former speechwriter to the Prime Minister. Earlier in the campaign, I asked him where Labour would want to see voters focus. Election Day is hours away. What are the words and the thoughts you want voters to have as they enter the polling booth?
Number one, the economy. It's got to be an election about the economy, not about Iraq, not about all the asylum issues and other issues the Tories want to raise. It's got to be, the economy's done really well, do you want that to continue or do you want it to be wrecked?
They have tried to drive this election on the economy.
They've tried to discuss the economy.
But while Labour has tried to talk about the economy and people seem to approve of what they've been doing, it's not the issue they end up talking about.
I believe the world is better with Saddam in prison and not in power. But
for me, one of the surprises of the campaign was that Tony Blair was able to find effective language when talking about Iraq, focusing not on the issue itself, but on making decisions and strong leadership.
And when you're sitting in the Prime Minister's chair, you've got to make the decision. And I took the view, at that time, unable to get the second resolution, unable to get any resolution with an ultimatum that was going to force Saddam to comply, I took the view it was better to remove him.
4 weeks ago, when I showed you anything about Tony Blair in Iraq, you reacted negatively. That, most of you reacted positively to. What was it about what he said that you felt positive?
Because he's believable there. You can see what he's saying. He's giving you the problem, saying, look,
I had to do something. I'm the Prime Minister. I'm the last guy in the line, yeah?
I didn't agree with the war and everything, but I think the way he was talking in this clip, he took the responsibility for it.
He was just telling the truth and he was stating absolute fact. And this is where the butt stops.
Asylum claims have fallen in Britain faster than anywhere else in Europe.
But how has Mr. Blair done on the issue that most angered our audience last time, asylum and immigration? At first, the reaction was negative and the lines fell. But the more that Tony Blair talks specifics, the more positive the reaction, and Labour voters actually agree with what he had to say.
They will be part of our first legislative programme if we're re-elected on May the 5th. And those controls will include the type, for example, of the point system used in Australia to help ensure our economy gets the skills we need.
But even with Tony Blair's effective language, nothing gets our participants more angry than the issues of immigration and asylum.
It's too late, I think. It's too late.
It's never too late. You shut the door now and then start sorting it out, you just can't keep letting people in.
No.
When this whole issue of immigration comes up, what's your reaction?
I'm more for immigration as long as it's for the help of the country, like the NHS, teachers, stuff, where we are short. That helps everybody.
There's no nurses and doctors because they don't pay any money.
That's why.
People are not going to go and be a nurse for 15 grand a year and get abused all year. And yeah. People will not like that anymore.
You've got a good service.
Pay nurses 25 grand a year, and you'd have.
They can't pay it, and like you said, you've been to the doctors, and you've had a good service in the hospital. If these people don't come in, you'll be left without a very down national health service.
It's a longer picture, isn't it?
We're talking about politics, y'all just sitting around. We're talking about candidates, you're all just sitting around. The moment immigration comes up, everybody jumps in. So how's the Conservative campaign been going? I met up with an old friend, Danny Finkelstein, former director of communications for the Conservatives and also a member of Newsnight's election panel.
If the Conservatives have only one word, a phrase, or sentence, the last thing they could say to voters in the last 48 hours, what should that be?
It's got to be action, not words. You've had all the talk from Blair. Now let's go and do something about the issues that matter to you.
I'm 63 years old. I have fought many battles in my life.
But has Michael Howard convinced our audience?
But I'm not going to do that, because there's another battle I have to fight.
Why was he going on about I, all I heard was I that.
He just hasn't learned the lessons.
At the same time, I think the Tories are aware that Labour have a charismatic figurehead, and they think the best way to fight one charismatic figurehead is by putting up another one. Whether that's right or wrong is...
And you think Howard's charismatic?
I'm not saying that I think he is. not at all.
How many of you think Michael Howard's the right guy to run the Conservatives? Raise your hands. One, two. How many of you think he's the wrong guy to run the Conservatives?
I don't think he'll win it.
Most of you.
But here in Milton Keynes, they're particularly fed up because they're doing something which they never promised. We want some members of Parliament who are going to say to the government what the people of Milton Keynes think, not just come to Milton Keynes and tell the people of Milton Keynes what Mr. Blair thinks.
You gotta give Michael Howard credit. He found a way to say Milton Keynes more times in a paragraph.
then mentioned Labour.
But was he expressive to you? Did he speak to you?
I like his positive attitude, I like his enthusiasm, but I don't, once again, like the way he's constantly having to bring down Labour to bring himself up.
As I switch off every time he starts slagging somebody off, I can't be bothered to listen to him.
Who do you think has waged a worse campaign? Labour? Or the Conservatives? How many of you would say Labour? Raise your hands. One. How many of you would say the Conservatives? Okay. What's wrong with the Conservative campaign?
It's just too negative.
Negative issues.
Very negative.
It's just that negative stuff towards Labour.
Finally, I took a ride with Ali Grender, the third member of Newsnight's election panel. She used to be the director of communications for the Liberal Democrats. And what we heard in Milton Keynes from the voters was exactly what she wanted to hear at the end of the campaign.
If a focus group is saying to you, what we felt about them was that they ran the election campaign in a slightly different way, in a different style. We felt there was a different tone about the way they were saying things, that they were prepared to sometimes be positive about their opponents, that they weren't always knocking their opponents. I think that's the kind of stuff that they'll want to hear coming through.
It's a positive programme. Positive programme for the governance of Britain as a whole. For our children.
Charles Kennedy and the Liberal Democrats got far and away the most positive response of the session.
He was the only one of the three leaders who didn't slag off anybody else.
He was referring to things which we value.
If you just talk about what you're going to do about it, that's enough.
And when it came to their voting preference, more of our swing voters told us they would switch to the Liberal Democrats than any other party. And yet they still seemed ill-informed about the policies or the details.
Who would say Lib Dems would do a better job on the economy? One. And yet 14 of you are voting for them. You don't know, and yet 14, half of you are voting for them. You people are putting your future in the hands of people that you don't know. You're crazy.
You don't know what they stand for, and yet you'd still...
No, because I just go with what I feel. Yeah, I just go, I follow my heart.
He comes across being more trustworthy, and you've got to give people a chance.
This sounds like John Lennon. All we are saying is give Lib Dems a chance. If these swing voters in this marginal constituency are any indication, the Liberal Democrats have run a very effective campaign by not attacking the Conservatives or Labour. Tony Blair can also feel very positive about capturing his voice on Iraq and on the economy. But Michael Howard is not going to like what he hears. The voters think that he's too negative and that the Conservatives aren't ready to take over. And for the voters themselves, perhaps they are the real losers, very hostile to the negativity that they heard from the candidates in this campaign. And that about sums up election 2005.
Does anyone here know how to get to Heathrow?
Frank Lance and our election panel, all former party strategists, as Frank Lance said, are with me now. Peter Hyman, Ollie Grender, and Ollie Finkelstein, who writes for Danny Finkelstein, who writes for The Times. Ollie Grender, it doesn't matter what the policies are as long as you're nicer. I mean, that really probably won't wash by tomorrow morning.
Well, I think people do go with their feelings a lot more than clever programs like Newsnight give people credit for, in a way. They do tend to have an emotional response. And, you know, we all know that because we've all done the research in the past. We know that what people do is when they vote, it has to be emotional. And sometimes it's an emotion of hatred, and sometimes it's a positive emotion. And that's all to the good. You know, that's fine.
Danny, do you think that's what the Liberal Democrats had to do this time?
Actually, I do. I think that when people buy products, it's often what it makes them feel about themselves. You know that L'Oreal statement, because I'm worth it. That's not because of what L'Oreal does for you. It's because of what you think of yourself when you buy it. And that was a very clever advertising slogan for that reason. And exactly the same way, I think people vote for political parties because it says about them.
And they believe that they're... Well, that's quite interesting. Because that means that many people believe they're nicer than either a man who wants to run the country that says liar, or a man who takes the country to war that didn't go to war.
Well, they benefited from a lack of scrutiny. I mean, the third party always has this. They've come on the outside. I thought from the beginning that Labour has underestimated the Lib Dems. It should have attacked...
Is that not quite patronising to the potential voters of the Liberal Democrats?
No, I'm just saying the two parties haven't train their fire. I mean, if either the Conservatives, I'm sure Danny would agree, or Labour had put forward the local income tax policy that hits very average earners, I mean, as everyone's pointed out, 20 or 40,000 both couples, they would have been crucified.
I don't want to go into a policy argument with you.
I'm not policy, but they would have been crucified, either of our parties, going into an election with that. But actually, no one's trained any fire on
it. The Lib Dems would probably, if they were here having this conversation with you, disagree very strongly, because they feel that the fire over this ludicrous 1 in 10 figure,
yeah.
has been going on for the last 3 days, and you know they're pretty wound up about that, and they feel they're under attack.
Is it not a kind of last resort? And it wouldn't have been the way, presumably, that Labour wanted the campaign to go. The Prime Minister had to practically come out with a little board saying, you know, 1 in 10 Labour deserts, you let the Tories in.
Well,
which, of course, we can argue if it's a fallacy.
We can argue
about
the statistics. It's actually very true.
As a tactic, though.
No, the problem in this election is
if a respected pollster has agreed with it.
No, but it's not whether he agrees with it. The problem is that what they've identified is accurate, which is if people en masse... No, the basic point is right. If lots of people think, I don't need to vote for Labour, other people will vote for Labour.
Yeah, but 1 in 10 is not the accurate figure.
Well, actually, it's not whether you quibble in 1 in 10 or 1 in 50.
Oh, well, so it's not telling the truth.
No, no, no. I think 1 in 10 you can stand up without going into the figure.
Well,
the basic point is true, that if everyone thinks that someone else is going to vote Labour, but I can send a signal... then the
Tories
will get back in.
Yeah, but aren't the voters smarter than that, Danny Finkelstein?
Well, I certainly think someone else can vote Labour. I think in the end that some people actually will take their message seriously and some people will vote Labour because they want, in the end, to defeat the Conservative Party. And that is obviously a lesson the Conservative Party has to think about.
Well, let's talk about the lessons the Conservative Party has to think, even at this stage before the polls open tomorrow morning, if the voters... the undecided Milton Keynes or anything to go by, and what they really hated was the negativity. And as Frank Lund said, when they became exercised, it was about immigration, and kind of what Michael Portillo said, the Victor Meldrew manifesto.
I think the Conservative Party campaign has been very professionally organised, it's been very disciplined, but if it doesn't achieve the result that the Conservative Party wanted, then I think the place to look is going to be in whether it had a positive enough message, and also in this whole question of how it made people feel about themselves. I don't think people think of themselves as angry. I don't think people think of themselves as wanting to shout at somebody. They think of themselves as being, you know, pleasant, moderate, compassionate, and the Conservative Party, if it doesn't achieve its result, will have to look at that.
Well, that's quite a, because Sir Bob Marshall said about the whole immigration strategy was, and he is involved in the London bid for the Olympics, is that people are embarrassed at the idea that they're seen to be unwelcoming of immigrants and actually would actually damage the bid.
Well, I mean, let's get this straight. My own opinion is that the view of AB professionals that this isn't a problem, isn't an issue, is mad. It is a big issue. It's a really important policy question. Yeah. I think the Conservative Party has raised something that all parties should grapple with, but whether it's an electorally successful gambit, that's a different question.
Tony Blair at the moment. What will he be thinking tonight? We saw him looking remarkably relaxed coming off the helicopter, where he had been looking remarkably unrelaxed and more... ill at ease with questions from either professional interviewers or the public as the election went on. In fact, he looked as if he didn't actually feel he ever wanted to answer a question.
Well, he was a bit, visibly irritated at times about Iraq because he feels he's sort of dealt with it. He feels it's a sort of back...
But he hasn't, clearly.
It did come back to, hang over the election very much, but he felt he'd dealt with it. He felt, in a sense, this is where the Lib Dems were being negative. They're voting for, they want people to vote for something that's happened rather than the next 5 years.
Except troop withdrawal is a future policy issue.
Again, if you want a policy that hasn't been subjected to scrutiny, troop withdrawal is a very good example of that.
I think
this isn't so necessarily say a negative point about the Liberal Democrats. The Liberal Democrats do, however, gain hugely by the fact that they can advance policies without the same critical scrutiny. And when you saw Charles Kennedy on Question Time, I think all three of us probably thought it was the most effective performance because no one asked questions about a policy that any of the other people would have been skinned alive.
I'm afraid I have to ask you all because you know about these things to predict the result tomorrow morning, Ollie.
Labour majority, about 90.
About 90?
Yeah.
Okay, and what Liberal Democrats do?
Liberal Democrats up, I think, about 10 to 20 seats.
Danny?
Well, I believe opinion polls, and so therefore I think that that's probably about right. In fact, it may even be optimistic from a Conservative point of view, that the majority could be slightly bigger than that.
I've got a cop-out answer, which is I think it is genuinely tighter in the marginals.
Yeah.
Peter's
going to be the only one that predicts a Tory victory on this
programme. I'm not predicting a Tory victory. No, I'm not predicting a Tory victory, but I think... I think the margin could be one very low or up to 100.
Right.
I think we don't know.
There's a man who hedges his bets. Thank you all very much. We look forward to seeing you on Friday's News Night. Tomorrow morning's front pages now. The Times, Blair set for a third term as Liberal Democrats advance, despite what Peter... says. The Guardian polls say Labour will win a historic third term. The Financial Times, Labour hopes high as fight ends. The Sun, come on you Reds, looks like Tony Blair and Gordon Brown heading for the same door as the Sun's headline. The Daily Mirror, they have Vote Labour, there's too much at stake with Michael Hurd as Dracula. The Independent carries us straight through the campaign from day one to polling day. And the Daily Mail don't put tomorrow's vote on their front pages at all. Vaccine could end cervical cancer for good and Abigail well enough to sit up in a chair. Well, that's all from Newsnight tonight. There's no programme tomorrow, but BBC One's election results programme starts at 5 to 10 tomorrow night. I'll be back on Friday with an extended Newsnight and with the team here too. So until then, vote early, but just the ones. Good night.
Who do you want to look after education?
The NHS.
Your pension.
And where to spend your money.
Election night's when we'll find out who'll be on top and who's being dropped.
All the issues.
All the angles.
All the results.
All on the BBC.
Election night. Tomorrow from 5 to 10 on BBC One, radio and online.
You want to come with me?
Because if you do, then I should warn you.
You're
going to see all sorts of things. Ghosts from the past. Aliens from the future. The day the Earth died in a ball of flame. It won't be quiet. It won't be safe. And it won't be calm. But I tell you what it will be. The trip of a lifetime.
Doctor Who. Saturday at 7 on BBC One.
Now running 10 minutes later than planned. Fame and infamy in a controversial and surprising career as BBC Two brings you a slice of BBC Four. Sexual scenes and strong language.